Today we got to talk about something very important that's going on in our society. So this is even bigger than the stock market. And I know what you're thinking, how can this be bigger than what's happening in the stock market? Because it's brutal out there. And yeah, I agree. And if you're not sleeping so well, because I know a lot of people aren't, well, let me just tell you, get some of that NyQuil nighttime stuff. It is great. Because after this video, you're going to be sleeping even worse. No, I'm kidding. Here, we're going to talk about a bunch of macro concepts, actually two in particular that are related, that kind of influence what's happening in the stock market and what's going to happen going into the future. And when we talk about this stuff, they are large concepts, and it does look pretty bad for our society, but don't get too depressed. Remember that the sun always comes out the next day, at least until, you know, global warming ruins everything. But until that point, we're pretty good, regardless of what macro things are happening. But I did want to share this with you guys because it's very interesting. And it once again gives context to what's been going on all around us, because things might feel a little off, right? They're getting more contentious and things are just rough. And you see a lot of that being translated into the stock market. So of course, everything is connected. Now we'll do our normal market review on Tuesday and get into the details of specifically what's happening in the market. But before that, let's go over these macro forces. And this story starts in Afghanistan. We're gonna use Afghanistan as an example. And this is coming from Alex, who's our lead researcher in macro ops. And if you know a little bit about Alex, you know that he's former military intelligence. So he actually lived in Afghanistan and he was working to figure out what was going on over there. So his job when he was employed by the US military was to go meet with drug kingpins and political elites and tribal leaders and all these different powerful people all over Afghanistan. And the idea was to keep a tab on what power structures were forming and what power structures were collapsing, right? So the US could assert their dominance. For what reason? Nobody knows. It didn't make any sense. But one of the interesting and very stupid things that happened during that time while he was working over there was that the US decided, hey, poppy fields, which Afghanistan has a lot of, are bad because guess what? Poppy creates heroin. Now, heroin, yes, that's bad, right? But before you just say heroin is bad, so let's exterminate all the poppy fields when you're working as a large government and doing all these geopolitical things, you gotta think a few steps ahead, right? But the US didn't do that, as you'll see in this story. So here's the thing about opium poppy. It is Afghanistan's biggest cash crop. They make like $1 billion a year off of it. They produce 80% of the world's poppies and they employ over 130,000 farmers. So it's a big deal in Afghanistan. And the US decided, hey, let's just kill that off. So you could already see where this is going. So the first thing the US decided was that, hey, why don't we just give these farmers incentives to burn their own crops? So what they would do is say, hey, if you get rid of all your poppy crops, we'll give you a bunch of money. So they tried that, and guess what? It failed. Basically, all these farmers, they gamed the system, and it didn't work. So the US decided, okay, if that didn't work, let's try the next step. Let's directly go after all the producers and the drug lords. So they went and tried that, but guess what happened? The big drug kingpins, they used this opportunity to sick the US on their smaller rivals. So the US went in and they started clearing out those guys, and the bigger guys, they just became more powerful. Pretty soon their poppy production was completely vertically integrated. And the result was the US was going after these smaller guys and the big guys actually increased total poppy production. So surprise, surprise, the US was trying to do one thing and it had the opposite effect. And on top of that, this move had another effect which was even worse, because these smaller guys, they were getting crushed now, right? So who did they call to come in and protect them? The Taliban. Now the Taliban used to love the drug trade because it was a major source of financing, but they had been pushed out. But now with what the US was doing to these smaller guys, now they're getting an inroad back in. So their second attempt at this plan didn't work, but the US didn't stop there because what was they thinking? Oh, poppy, opium, bad, creates heroin, bad, let's stop all this. Third grade level just cause and effect thinking right there. So then they moved on to attempt number three, and this time they were just getting rid of the poppy fields themselves, which means flying overhead with a plane and dropping stuff on them to eradicate them, using security forces to burn them, arrest people who are working on them, just forcefully destroy it. And this actually worked. Poppy production did fall for a bit, and it absolutely devastated the economy. So a lot of farmers and stuff, they had to rip up their families and go travel somewhere else. They became refugees because their whole life and their business, it was taken away. And these poppy farmers weren't bad people or anything. They were just doing their job and they were relatively well off because of it. But when the US destroyed all of this, it ruined them. Because sure, opium sounds bad because it creates heroin, but for these farmers, it's their crop. It's like corn, right? So if you went and destroyed all the corn fields, how would the corn farmers feel? So a lot of these former farmers, they had to uproot their families and move, right? They were refugees now. And where did they go? They went east. They went into Pakistan. And you know what ended up happening to these people? They become radicalized and they joined the Taliban because they had no other choice. So like I said, this plan worked in the short term. For the next 12 months, poppy production dropped. But then guess what happened? All of it just moved east. So it got restarted again, and then they were creating more poppy than they ever were before. So the US policies and everything they did, not only did it not stop poppy production, in fact, it increased it. But not only that, it turned the tide in favor of the Taliban. Because the US came in and screwed everything up, all these people that became refugees, they relied on the Taliban. And the Taliban became the eventual winners in that region. So the local people, because of what happened, they stopped giving intelligence to the US. Instead, they turned sides and they were harboring Taliban fighters. So you could pretty much draw a clear line from the US's anti-drug policies to the resurrection of the Taliban and their power. And the Taliban had been trying to gain power for a long time and they couldn't do it. The US had to come in and screw up to give it back to them. So the question is, how could the US be so stupid to enact this policy and completely ruin the region and give it back to the Taliban? Well, are they stupid? No, they're not stupid, right? So what is it? The problem is elite overproduction. So what do we consider an elite? An elite is basically anyone who's making more money and has more influence than everyone else. So think about the wealth gap that we currently have. There's a few haves and a bunch of have-nots, right? So some of the people in the haves would be considered elites, and they're in elite positions. So think politicians, bankers, things like that. Now there's a major problem that happens when you have too many elites in a society due to the inequality. What happens is that these elites, they get bored and they start competing with each other, to the detriment of the entire society because they don't care. Now, why do these elites compete? Because they already have a bunch of power and money and influence. Like, why do they want to mess with each other? Well, you've seen Billions, right? We used to make videos about it all the time. These guys are just constantly in a dick measuring contest. And the problem is that they will go through their little squabbles with no regard for who it affects or what it creates in society. And when they have so much power and influence, everything they do affects the rest of us. So you can look at what happened in Afghanistan and think, who was making those policies? Elites, right? And why were they doing it? Because it didn't make any sense. Well, okay, you want to get rid of heroin. Why do you want to get rid of heroin? Is it a political move? Because obviously they don't care about the people being affected by heroin, right? And if you look at the bigger scheme of things, that wasn't the right way to go about getting rid of it by destroying Afghanistan. So if you look at it, really what it was political posturing to get votes, to remain in power, to beat their opponent. So there's not even a thought of what it actually produces, the negative effects. No one cares. And a lot of these elites, they have zero accountability. I mean, think back to 2008. Did anyone go to jail for that? No, of course not. Because you can't pin it on any one person. Now there's a really smart guy named Peter Turchin who studies historical cycles, and he came up with a theory called SDT, and that's short for structural demographic theory. Now the whole idea of structural demographic theory is to go into the factors that cause instability in a society, because we know each society, it goes in waves, right? It goes in cycles. It's up and then it's down. And one of the biggest drivers of a society eventually collapsing is what we just talked about, an overproduction of elites, because they do stupid stuff like this story in Afghanistan. And they're doing stupid stuff today. We're all affected by it. Now, Turchin does a lot of SDT models, and in his modeling, we crossed a critical point in 2020. So now the underlying conditions in the Western world are ripe for war, political strife, and instability. It's not looking good. And we're gonna remain like this until our system goes through a huge correction and gets cleared out, which also is not a fun process. Now, this leads to the next threat that we're facing, and that's information. Now, think about this. There was more information created in 2001 than every other year of history combined. And that number has been doubling every year since, so it's moving at an exponential rate. And why? Well, obviously the internet helps with that, right? More and more information is being pumped. But here's what happens when there's a bunch of information in a society with more and more coming. It increases uncertainty. And when you have more uncertainty, you have more distrust for authority. And that eventually leads to a collapse of the power structures that are in place in a society. So when you have a bunch of access to information, information flowing everywhere, what happens is that when an institution, one that's supposed to be respected and trusted, like say a group of scientists, when they come out and say, hey, This new virus, it's pretty dangerous. But what happens is that you have a whole group of people that say, hey, I did my own research online and I don't think this is dangerous at all. It's stupid, it's fake, it's a hoax. And we'd like to think that that's just a small group of stupid people, but no, it's not, because this starts happening to everyone. And pretty soon, any institution that releases information, you know, that they've researched and they're supposed to be the authority, everyone else is like, hey, is that really real? Because they could just take any information they want and cherry pick to support their narrative, which is true, but the same thing can happen on the other side. And I've seen this same thing happen on the health side, say about carbs. You got a lot of smart people that are in really good shape saying carbs are terrible, right? They will kill you. And then you have another group of people that are also really smart, also in great shape saying, hey, carbs are great. How do you know which to trust? How do you know which one is real? How do you know that the keto diet isn't just Atkins rebranded? And on any side of any debate that you look at, everyone has tons of information and facts to back up what they're saying. So what happens is that no one trusts anything. And now in the 2020s, we have another big factor at play, and that's AI. So you've seen what AI has been able to do, right, with this GPT-3. It can basically create an endless supply of intelligent essays and tweets and videos. They could do deep fake videos that all look really real. And when you're looking at it and understanding it, you're like, yeah, this makes a lot of sense. And before you know it, you start thinking that the earth is flat because you did your own research. And that research is actually coming from an AI bot that just sounds convincing. So now, on top of governments like Russia and China spreading misinformation, you got AI robots doing the same thing. And everyone has access to these bots. You could literally just have it on your phone. And every piece of information that you see going forward, you can't really trust, can you? So here's the thing, when you have a society that has a structure with the elites on top, one of the ways that they control the rest of the society is through information dissemination. But what happens when all of a sudden now there's information coming from everywhere and you don't know what's real and what's not and what is actually backed by facts? Well, what happens is that the hierarchy and the authority structures, they can't survive this new wave of information. And what happens is that the authority structure collapses. And it collapses because all the people on the periphery with all this information, they make it happen. But the problem is that there's no real answer for who governs after that. It just kind of becomes chaos because nothing actually comes in to fill the void. So, and that's literally what's happening right now. So you end up with a great flattening where there's just a bunch more variance and chaos and a lot more upside, but a lot more downside too. And just one of the small ways that you're seeing that is with how crazy the stock market is right now. Now I want to hear what you think about this. Make sure you comment down below. I'm sure you got a bunch of examples of seeing this happen already. And we'll get into market specifics on Tuesday, so if you want to see that, make sure you subscribe, and I will see you then.